Hello and welcome. In the next few lectures, we're going to be talking about doing causal inference and when and how we can make causal claims about the relationships between the variables that we're studying. Most of our causal theories involve the relationship between two variables, how an independent variable X causes a dependent variable Y. These are called bivariate theories because they are strictly about the relationship between two variables. So, for example, how does a person's race affect their likelihood of voting in a particular election? How does the level of religious fragmentation in a country affect the likelihood that there will be a civil war in that country? How does a country's experience fighting a war affect the economic well-being of that country in the future? Things like this are strictly about the relationship between a particular independent variable X and a dependent variable Y. In reality, of course, the world is a much more complicated place than that. Outcomes like voter turnout are affected by many, many variables, not just one that we might identify in our causal theory. So how do we understand bivariate theories in this multivariate world that we live in? Well, we have to take into account all of the other variables, which we're going to generically call Z, how all those other variables also affect the outcome that we're interested in, and make sure that we take all of that complexity into account as we try to assess whether our theory is true. If when we do our research, we only look at the relationship between the two variables that we're most interested in, we are likely to make bad inferences. A classic example of this is looking at the relationship between ice cream consumption and violent crime. In this graph here, you can see that the ice cream sales rate in the course of a year and the violent crime rate over the course of the year are very closely related to one another. These lines match up very closely over the course of a year. So why do we see this relationship? And does this mean that we should stop selling ice cream to prevent violent crime? As we've talked about before, there are a couple of reasons why we might see a close association between two variables. One option is that there is a causal bivariate relationship between the variables. For example, that ice cream consumption causes the rate of violent crime, or that the rate of violent crime causes the rate of ice cream consumption. Either of those stories about the causal connection between those two variables could be the source of seeing an association between the variables. And then, of course, there's also the possibility that the association is driven by a third variable, that the association between these two variables that we're looking at is spurious. So, for example, in the ice cream and violent crime case, one of the reasons this is a classic example is because the ice cream consumption rate is strongly associated with temperature throughout the year. So people are much more likely to eat more ice cream when it's hot outside. And temperature also has a causal relationship with the violent crime rate. So violent crime rates are higher when the weather is nicer and people are more likely to be outside and more likely to be interacting with one another instead of snuggled up in their houses. So the violent crime rate is higher when the weather is warmer. So the relationship between ice cream consumption and violent crime rate is not causal in that bivariate sense, because both of those variables are driven by an external variable, a third variable, temperature. So just because we observe an association between two variables does not mean that there is a causal connection between those variables. The relationship that we see could be driven by third variables. And even if the connection between those variables is causal, we don't know the direction of causality necessarily. So the complication of the world that we live in makes it hard to evaluate bivariate theories, but it doesn't make it impossible. There are still ways to find a causal connection between variables that we're looking at. What we have to do is to figure out a way to control for the other possible causes of Y. So we need to take into account the other variables that might be influencing in some way the outcome that we're looking at and might be making it more difficult for us to pin down the exact relationship between the independent variable X and the dependent variable Y that we're looking at. So if we don't control for these other variables, which we're calling z, then we might come to the wrong conclusion about the relationship between x and y. So in the next couple of lectures, we're going to be talking about research design strategies that let us control for z, that let us take these other variables z into account when we're looking at the relationship between x and y. So we're going to get into those more practical research design strategies shortly, but first, in the end of this lecture, we're going to talk about what exactly we mean when we talk about causes and causality. So we have been throwing around this language of X causing Y, or Y causing X, or Z causing Y in this video, but what exactly do we mean when we talk about causality? Well, it turns out that in the philosophy of science literature, there's actually quite a bit of debate about what exactly causality means. Most of that debate is not really relevant to what we're doing here, but I do want to talk about two main types of causality. These are deterministic and probabilistic causality. So deterministic causality means that if X occurs, then some outcome Y will always happen. So there is a deterministic relationship between X and Y. Whether X occurs determines whether Y occurs. A probabilistic causal relationship says that if X occurs, then Y is more likely. So just because X happens, that doesn't mean that Y is necessarily going to happen. But there is a probabilistic relationship, so it becomes more probable that some outcome Y will happen if a given condition X happens. In the social sciences, we are usually talking about a probabilistic causal relationship between the variables that we're interested in. There are certainly some fields where identifying deterministic causal relationships is possible. For example, if you're a chemist, you might know that if you mix chemical compound A and chemical compound B under the right circumstances, then chemical reaction C will always occur. There's a deterministic relationship between mixing those compounds and getting this particular reaction. But in the social world, usually we don't have those kinds of deterministic relationships. We live in a probabilistic world. There is a well-known theory in political science called the theory of economic voting, which relates the likelihood of an incumbent politician being re-elected to how well the economy is doing, with the idea being that if the economy is doing poorly, people are more likely to blame politicians already in office for that and punish them electorally. A deterministic interpretation of this theory would say that if the economy is doing poorly, then the incumbent will always lose the election that they're running in. And this is probably not true. That's probably not the case that any time the economy is not doing well, that the incumbent will never ever win. We live in a probabilistic world. A probabilistic interpretation would say that when the economy is doing poorly, the incumbent is less likely to win the election, more likely to lose. So just keep in mind throughout the rest of this course that when we talk about causality, we are taking this probabilistic view. So that has been our lecture introducing causation in the social sciences. The next few lectures in this series are going to continue exploring these concepts and how we do causal inference in practice. Thank you for listening. I'll see you next time.